The joint informational hearing of the Senate Committees on Public Safety and Budget and Fiscal Review Subcommittee Number 4 and the Assembly Budget Subcommittee Number 4. As you all may remember, through our budget negotiations agreed upon in February, there was need for further cuts when the 12-cent gasoline excise tax was taken off the table. And among the $2 billion that was necessary, $400 million was identified through a line item veto of the governor. It is our collective tasks to identify where those $400 million will be found. And the purpose of this informational hearing today is to review the department's beginning proposal to identify those $400 million. So we have the secretary with us. Welcome, Mr. Kate.
Finance is here as well. If
you and I believe we have the Department of Finance. Ms. Cahoe. I see you have brought a handout. Thank you for that. Everyone should have it. And just to clarify for everyone, that which we're reviewing today is just to begin to complete the task of the $400 million identified in February. This has nothing to do with the governor's most recent pronouncements of additional releases and cuts. That's not the purpose of today's hearing. Welcome, Mr. Secretary.
Thank you.
There you go.
Oh, there we go. All right. No. With that start, thank you very much, Mr. Chair, for inviting me here today in the department. I brought our Legislative Affairs Director, Joyce Hayhoe, with me, as well as our Budget Director, Dave Lewis. They're both to my left. I'd like to begin, if I could, with just a brief overview of the administration's proposal to cut the $400 million. It starts with a reform proposal concerning who and how we manage parole. So, and the way I kind of like to begin is to first describe what the administration's proposal was last winter, which basically, if you had a piece of paper in front of you and you drew a line down the middle of the page, you had our serious violent and sex offenders on one half of the page. The previous proposal was those people stayed on parole. All the non-serious, non-violent, non-sex offenders were off parole. So this current proposal is different somewhat in that on that column of non-serious, non-violent, non-sex offenders, we recognize that by using our validated risk assessment tool, we can further categorize the risk of these people to reoffend. And the proposal here is to take those who are high risk to reoffend, even though they've never committed a serious violent or sex offense at this point, and move them across the ledger and treat them as if they were a high-level offender because they are high risk. That would leave the among the group of non-serious, non-violent, non-sex offenders, those who are the low and moderate risk would be those that would be off parole in our proposal. They would be dismissed from parole, and instead they would be placed on something we have been calling community supervision as a placeholder to provide a handle for us to talk about it. Really what it is 3 years of search and seizure. So that if contacted by a police officer, a deputy sheriff, on a CHP officer, they would be able to look in what's known as CLETS, our automated records, and see that this person's searchable, and they would be able to check in and conduct a search to see what if anything, this person is up to, if they have any illegal evidence of illegal activity on them. So that saves a lot of money. The numbers, I think, are before you, but our proposal is to take a segment of that money and shift it across the ledger so that we can increase the supervision of our serious offenders, our violent offenders, our sex offenders, and all of our high-risk offenders, regardless of their criminal history. Right now, our parolee to parole agent ratio is 70 to 1. And we would propose to reduce that to 40 to 1. And what that allows us to do, frankly, is to change the entirety of our parole system. So rather than expecting our agents to spend most of their time as a cop catching offenders, at a lower ratio, they would be able and expected to spend their time acting both as an agent of rehabilitation and as an agent of law enforcement. Which is really what parole was intended to be in the first place. We would also add to our fugitive apprehension teams. We currently have 60 agents searching for about 15,000 fugitives statewide. And I think the tragedy in Oakland is an example of the importance of increasing our fugitive apprehension team members. And then we would increase also the number of our high-risk, high-level offenders who we put on GPS. As again, these are basically, from a law enforcement perspective, really an opportunity to supervise our low-level offenders less and supervise our high-level offenders and high-risk offenders more. And that still results in significant savings, both in terms of the number of agents and officers, obviously, that would be doing this work, but also in terms of all of the, well, for example, every time one of these low-level offenders goes to prison, we must do a medical evaluation and treatment under the Plata case, a mental health evaluation and treatment under the Coleman case, a dental evaluation and treatment under the Perez case, an ADA evaluation and the provision of any implements necessary under the Armstrong case, and the list goes on. And that term is usually about 4 months. The individual is released, and if they come back, that cycle starts all over again. So that's where the savings really comes from in this part of the proposal. Then the other two legs of really this are big legs. There's a couple others. One is credits. The proposal would be to provide up to 5 weeks of credit per year to eligible inmates. Those are inmates who are not in the serious violent sex offender class, for accomplishments. The expert panel on recidivism reduction reported to this body and to the governor more than a year ago now that providing incentives for inmates to accomplish significant achievements that are evidence-based and known to reduce recidivism is an important point in our efforts to reduce the state's overall recidivism rate. And so the idea here is to say it's fine to be in class, but you don't get these additional credits unless you actually get that GED, unless you actually earn that high school diploma, unless you actually satisfy your vocational instructor that you have met the requirements for a certificate in carpentry, a certificate in welding, what have you. These are real skills that our inmates need to be successful, and we want to prioritize the accomplishment, not just the attendance. And so that's the credits proposal. There's some other pieces to that, but that's the bulk of it. And then property crimes is a simple proposal to take grand theft, for example, which has been at $400 for 20 years, index it to inflation, to current inflation rates. That would be true for all the various property crimes we have in California. The Division of Juvenile Justice is currently going through a process of developing a new business model. We expect to generate savings there. And we ordered a just flat across the board 5% cut of all headquarters positions. And so there are savings there as well. Would love to engage in additional discussion and answer any of your questions. Did I miss anything, gentlemen?
Sayho?
I would just like to add, Joyce Hayhoe from the Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation, that some of the proposals before you are exactly alike or very, very similar to legislation that was passed by this body under AB 8X. Specifically, the part for property crimes is exactly alike that proposal. And our credit proposal is very, very similar. The only thing that we did there was we took the Senate's and Assembly's proposal of 4 months of credit, and we now are saying 5 weeks per year.
Thank you. It is very similar to the AB 8X. I know everyone's going to have questions for you, but I thought we might back up a little bit and take a broader view of this because specifically with regard to the reforming of parole, we're talking about doing things differently than we've done them most recently, and this might arise some discomfort among some legislators or even from our constituents. But the way we've been doing it since we switched from indeterminate to determinate sentencing is, as I understand it, fairly uncommon, if not unique, among the United States. So that when we did have indeterminate sentencing through the late 1970s, parole was then an opportunity for folks to leave the institution and return to the community, and there were agreed upon terms.
Right.
Do we know of any other states that have a determinate sentencing structure, but then also parole?
Well, your point is well taken. Parole is actually a misnomer in California in that it connotes the early release of someone beyond, before their statutory term has expired. In California, what we really is more properly termed post-release supervision, in that you serve your statutory term minus your credits, and you're placed on parole, whether you've agreed to be placed on parole or not. You really don't have a choice. You're on parole. I believe there may be two or three other states that have everyone on parole. Some of those may be indeterminate sentencing states. I know that on average, most states have about two-thirds. If you took the aggregate of all states it's a mishmash of different systems in different states, but generally about two-thirds of the offenders are on parole. In some states, the offenders who are on parole are your least serious offenders, because the most serious offenders are not released from prison at all. They serve the entirety of their term and then are released only at that point, and so there is no parole. In other states, which are post-supervision release states, they tend to have only their high-level offenders on parole, and their low-level offenders are directly discharged after serving their term. We have, I think, for whatever reason, adopted kind of the most intense of both models, where you serve all of your term and everyone is placed on parole, and that does make us fairly unique.
And I think it's also true that in most states, the average length of parole is somewhere between 12 and 18 months, and we have ostensibly 3 years. 12 to 18 months. We have ostensibly 3 years for everybody, irrespective of nature or severity of crime or time spent in prison.
Right.
And so again, I lay all this out just so we all understand. We've got a more than exaggerated current system. We're trying to see where we can refine it with the concern of public safety first and foremost, but still reach something that will afford us some of the savings that we all agreed upon in February.
Correct. The three years is the minimum. Some are 5 years of parole. You can be released from parole if you're a low-level offender after 13 months, if you've committed no violations, and similarly at 25 months, if you're a higher-level offender and have no violations. The difficulty, of course, is that we also have technical violations that are a part of every system of parole that can lengthen that parole term. The other concern I have is this problem of how much supervision do we actually do at a 70-to-1 ratio, and how much crime do we actually prevent when we ask our agents to do so much with so many offenders. That's the other part that I'd really like to see addressed in this proposal, and that someone with a law enforcement background, that's the part that I confess really appeals is the chance to let our parole agents do what we really are paying them to do.
That's a good segue into what is an obvious first question is, how did you reach the number 40? Is this based on some studies or any other kind of experience that we have?
There are, again, all different models out there. And we know that that range between 40 to 50 to 1 is been shown in other states to work. My parole people have basically, when I ask them, what do you need to really let an agent, if we're going to, for example, if we're going to tell an agent, you're no longer just expected to meet your specs or your specifications on how many times you visit a parolee, how many times they send in a postcard, how many times you check, you make them do a drug and alcohol urinalysis. But we also say we're going to start measuring your success based upon your parolee's success. Then what does that caseload need to be? And that was the range that they gave me as something that would give them an opportunity to do both sides of that job well.
With regard to the kind of supervision that those who will be released from parole will be experiencing, along with the adjustments to the inmate credits, what level of opportunity do we really provide in fact, not just in words? So if someone wants to get into a class, if someone wants to get into a job training program, I get mixed messages that in fact they're not actually there when someone's interested.
I mean presently in the prison system?
Correctly.
Okay, yeah. As a foundational point, until the last 6 months, we weren't able to tell you what the criminogenic need of the offender was. So we couldn't even tell you what the academic, who needed drug and alcohol help, who needed to learn a vocation or trade. We relied on the inmates to tell us, and that wasn't always accurate. But now we are testing everybody who comes in, so that was an important first step. We have, the drug and alcohol need is about 55% of our total offenders, and this is off the top of my head, so forgive me.
I've heard maybe even higher.
Well, we thought it was too. Mm-hmm. I mean, when I say 55%, I mean 55 to 60% have a heavy need. So there may have been a less serious need than others, but as far as those who have a heavy need, and I'm trying to remember now. I think it's. I don't know, Joyce, if you remember the total numbers who are in drug and alcohol programs in CDCR, but it's in the neighborhood of 20,000 to 30,000 that are in. Now, that doesn't meet the need but if you identify it and you get the proper dose, say it's 6 months, we could make sure that offenders, you can reach more offenders during a year in a single class if you do it right. Part of our problem is we're currently so overcrowded, there's no empty bed to transfer the inmate who's completed the program into, so that bed can be freed up to an inmate who needs it, and so on and so forth. And so without any flex room, we tend to leave inmates in programs for a longer period than the science would say is the appropriate dose. So I guess that's a long way of saying that it's a complicated problem, but you're right. We don't meet the needs of all of our offenders currently, but we have been improving in that area every year.
Okay, I've got many other questions, but I know my colleagues do as well. So my vice chair, Senator Benoit.
Thank you, Secretary, for your testimony and efforts at trying to innovatively approach the needs that the governor's identified and we've identified in that spending. And I appreciate the briefing I received in the governor's office and our discussion that we've had in the past. I left there with a question that I want to ask again. Because while certainly the soundbite sounds good, I'm not saying I'm ready to jump in and support, but I got to say that the soundbite of 3 years of a search and seizure to a guy who used to be in the patrol car, that has appeal to me. And as we discussed, particularly if that information is readily available through generally accessible systems to any peace officer working in the state of California. I guess the biggest question that I heard after talking about that proposal with others is, legally, how can we be assured that the courts are going to uphold the ability for us to place that requirement on the newly released community supervised former inmate?
Right. It's an open question to some extent. I can't tell you that we're 100% sure of what any court will do. Our legal research is really premised on the fact that parole stopped being voluntary a long time ago. And so if we can place someone on parole with a search and seizure requirement, then we actually see it as a lesser intrusion into what would otherwise be your constitutional rights based on public safety to place you only on supervision. Now, you know, there's some changes have to be made because of the historically supervision and search and seizure have been tied to something called parole, which we'll have to call it something else. But it's actually a lower level of intrusion into what would otherwise be a citizen's Fourth Amendment rights than parole is, because you don't have someone looking over your shoulder, you can't go back for a technical violation. All of those things have been wiped off. So that's the core of the legal theory. As a belt and suspenders approach, we are open to the idea of crafting the legislation in such a way that we would say if a court of competent jurisdiction makes a final ruling that this is illegal, inoperative, violates the Constitution, then as a fallback, we would have a system, you might call it bank parole, where we would say you're reinstituted on parole for the purposes of search and seizure only. If we needed to do that to make sure that we got the right result that, assuming everyone agreed on, that we've described here. It's not as clean. I don't like the idea of the Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation being responsible for these folks on parole while not supervising and not providing program to them. I think it's more the intellectually honest approach is to say these folks are either on or they're off. But nonetheless, that's a possible fallback.
I think that it would be important for the benefit of my colleagues as we move forward that you share with us in as much detail as you have available to you the legal arguments and the proposed language as early as possible, because I think that's going to be a huge concern to a number of my colleagues.
I'd be happy to do that, Senator.
Mr. Rambula.
Thank you. Hello, Mr. Secretary. Help me with my math. The governor blue penciled $400 million. I've done a quick addition of the elements of the proposals that you have shared with us this morning, and I don't get to $400 million.
I think it's closer to $315.
Yeah. Well, explain, are we not going to hit the $400 million, or is there some component of the proposal that is not yet before us?
It's no, your math is right, and the numbers get a little worse every day that we don't take this up and put it into place, of course. But the governor's order to me was to get to $400 million, but to do so without derailing our efforts to rehabilitate our offenders and reform the system and without imperiling public safety. And so between that Scylla and Charybdis of those two banks, we charted this middle course. And what happened was we let policy dictate first, and this is where we ended up. Obviously, some additional savings might be found if you rose the ratios a little bit. There might be additional savings if you were to increase the credits a little bit. There's some things that we could do in working with your subcommittee and also Senator DeSaunier's to work on the numbers. In the out year, though, the numbers, you know, in 10-11, we see numbers closer to $470 million, which obviously is very helpful. But we just, I guess the short answer is we really tried to let the policy dictate first.
Okay. I'm hopeful that in the long run we would see additional savings, but this year, as you know, is extremely difficult, and any sum, you know, in this case, about $85 million or so, that is not achieved through the savings that the governor outlined. It's going to have to come out of somewhere else.
Right.
And I would really encourage you to redouble your efforts to make sure we come up to that $400 million. That may well be a starting point as we move along in these budget discussions. Not a ceiling, but a floor. Because, I mean, we held a hearing and, you know, $5 or $10 million may keep seniors from being evicted from their homes because they can't pay their property taxes. Another $5 or $10 million may provide health insurance for an innumerable number of children. You know, that's a significant sum, $85 million. And, you know, I know that you're focused on policy, but policy and budgeting have to intersect.
Right.
And, you know, we could well make good policy arguments for other areas that should not have to suffer reductions because the governor blew pencil $400 million and then you know, you can't come up with it. In terms of the proposal for parole reform, help me understand this. Currently, folks are released. Folks serve their time. They are then released on parole, and a number of them who are less serious and have no violations only have 13 months of parole, and then they're released from parole, correct?
That's right. My colleagues can correct me if I'm wrong on this. Again, off the top of my head, as I recall, about 50% of those low-level offenders end up being discharged from parole at the 13th month, and the remainder end up serving the entirety of their 3 years.
And some, I believe you said, at 25 months also came off.
Right. So the higher level offenders have their first opportunity at 25 months.
Okay. So let's say half are released at 13 months. The proposal before us is to have this 50% who is currently released from all parole at 13 months, subject to 3 years of search and seizure. Why, if we don't insist on that now, would we want to up the standard going forward?
It's really a nod to our colleagues in law enforcement, and it's a recognition that—
It's an expensive nod.
Well, it's also a recognition that during that 13 months, there's no supervision from the state as far as you know, having to go to the parole agent, as far as having to submit to your analysis, all of those the things that a parole agent coming into your house and meeting with your, seeing who you're meeting with, those kind of things, that's not going to happen during those 13 months. And so it's just a horse trade in a sense of less supervision than you would have received, but for a little longer period of time. And there's really nothing more complicated about it than that. It's just a rough trade of longer period of less supervision.
Now, help me understand under the current parole system, if someone is in technical violation of their parole conditions, their parole can be revoked and they are sent back to state facilities for breaching their parole, correct?
Correct.
With a short stint at the local facility, I assume. And the desire of this proposal, as I understand it, is to avoid having that revolving door where people serve their time, are placed on parole, commit a technical violation, are committed to a local facility, waiting placement back into a state facility for 4 to 6 months, sentence for violating their parole conditions. We can't do anything with those folks during that 4 to 6 months, really, in terms of rehabilitation. So it's churning. It's rotating these folks in and out of our institutions. There are savings in the parole reform proposal, presumably because these folks would not be churning back into the state facilities. But if they're under search and seizure for up to 36 months, what happens if during search and seizure there is some condition, or, you know, if something is found, will they be sent back to a state facility? Or what happens if during search and seizure something improper is found? What happens to those folks?
Well, we know that some of those individuals will once again fail to comply with the requirements of state law, and if they do so at a serious enough level, they'll be arrested by a local law enforcement officer for that violation. They'll go have a jury trial and be sent to state prison for could be a considerable period of time. But at least during that period, as you've pointed out, we'll have enough time to address those criminogenic needs that we discussed earlier, which you're right, we can't address in less than 6 months. For less serious, though, there will be those individuals who, for example, have committed a misdemeanor violation. Under the current system, we would place a parole hold on that person, and then they could either be tried for that misdemeanor and sent to the county jail for 1 year or less, or their parole could be revoked and they could be sent to state prison for, you know, the 4 month term that you described. That option of sending that person back to a state prison for 4 to 6 months would no longer be available. So that would be the primary difference, which I think our law enforcement partners have identified as a potential shift in cost from the state to the counties.
But if we have currently half of the folks getting off parole after 13 months, why would we extend it to 36 months?
Well again, if you're not breaking the law, the additional requirement of search and seizure will, while impacting certainly on a matter of your civil liberties, you've given something up. You're not going to be reincarcerated at any level as long as you're not violating the law. The thing you've avoided also is the truly technical violation. We do have, I think it's 17% of our offenders who come back for things like a dirty test or failing to attend a class or failing to show up to your appointment to your parole agent, and they would be immune from those violations altogether.
I'm still struggling as to why we would increase supervision or the search and seizure for 36 months when currently after 13 months they are not subject to search and seizure or parole revocation whatsoever. I understand and it may be more politics than policy, frankly, but it bothers me because we seem to be increasing the period during which people can be found liable for having committed improper activities. Given that we have not yet hit the $400 million, it makes me wonder whether this approach of 36 months would in fact drive up the cost somewhere in the system. It may not affect the state in terms of CDCR's costs, but it could well result in additional expenses at the local level for local facilities and for local law enforcement. But anyway, Mr. Chairman, thank you for allowing me to ask these questions. I do think a number of the other areas have merit and should be pursued for the parole reform. At least in my view, I don't think we have yet gone far enough.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have questions from Senator Hancock, and then Senator Huff, and then Senator Negrete McLeod.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I'd like to thank the department as well for what are clearly very thoughtful recommendations. And as Mr. Arambula pointed out, maybe only a first step since we haven't gotten to the $400 million yet. I'm very pleased to see that you are doing the risk and needs assessment, which I assume takes place when a person is incarcerated and then again before they're released, so that we know what kind of programs they need in order to have any chance of making it outside of prison. But I do have some questions again about the parole reform proposal. And one is that you're talking about putting 4,000 offenders on GPS monitoring, an additional 4,000. How are you going to select these people? And honestly, who is going to monitor them? And how does that actually work?
Sure. The way we envisioned it was that approximately half of those 4,000 would be used as an alternative sanction. As an alternative to incarceration.
Also, it would be like a probation.
Right. So if you're, I apologize, I'll go just a little bit afield of your question, if you'll permit me to talk a little bit about how we monitor parolees now. We're right in the middle of changing the way that we handle violations of parole. What we've done is we've now that we have this risk assessment tool that we can assess the risk of a parolee committing a new offense, we're utilizing that as part of a parole violation decision-making instrument to help guide our agents and deputy commissioners in making better informed decisions about who should go back to prison and who should be left in the community with a lesser sanction. One of the things we struggle with and we know that we could improve upon is that there are not enough serious alternatives to prison. So if you've committed a low-level offense, there are plenty of classes we can send you to. We can always put a curfew on. We can make you go to counseling. We can do those kinds of things. But a more serious offense that doesn't quite rise to the level that you need to be reincarcerated, there aren't enough of those kind of in-house programs, community custody programs. There's not just not enough available for our 115,000 parolees. And so these 2,000 GPS units would be available for agents or deputy commissioners to say, you've come as close to going back to prison as we feel comfortable with, and as a serious sanction, we're going to place this GPS monitor on you and watch you like a hawk over the next 6 months or whatever it may be as an alternative to sending you back. And that actually saves money because, again, we don't have to go through all the costs that Senator Leno described. Then the other 2,000 GPS units would be used, in our view, on especially your high-risk gang members that are really, how it is with any group of people. You have 10% who seem to cause 90% mm-hmm. of the problems. Mm-hmm. Well, we've been using GPS on high-level gang offenders in various communities throughout the state on a pilot basis. And we would just expand that pilot to see if we can provide some public safety to especially our urban areas that are struggling so much with gang violence. If I can be frank with this group, the rate at which we revoke people who are on GPS as a prophylactic measure right out of the gate is very high. They were revoked at a very high rate. And it's because we've been targeting these people who are high-risk gang offenders to put that on in the first place. But a parole agent would have about 40 of these people on their caseload, and they would not be watching day and night, but they can use that tool to identify, were you in the place where X crime was committed? Those kinds of police investigative tactics.
Okay, so in other words, you're on parole. You have a 40-to-1 caseload, let's say. And literally, the parole officer can click and find out where you are at any time. It isn't like somebody sitting watching a TV screen.
Right. For our high-risk sex offenders, we actually check in with them on a daily basis, and we'll watch their movement at a 20-to-1 ratio. This is what we call passive use of GPS, where we may check it at the end of the day to look for aberrations. To see whether you're back into the gang neighborhood where you've been restricted or those kind of things, but it's not the kind of minute-by-minute observation. We just don't have enough money or agents for that.
Right. Well, I'm trying to follow the thread and imagine what this, might look like. So a person is takes the risk assessment when they come into prison. If they're one of the people that have a drug or alcohol problem, and the numbers I've heard are very large, too, from various people who've been connected with the prison system, if they have a drug or alcohol problem or a literacy problem, if they're really not equipped to have a job outside, what do we do for them? Do we have facilities in our prisons that can prepare them for return with any chance of success, since with determinant sentencing, most of them will be back out on the street?
Right. That was one of the restrictive points the governor ordered, was that we keep our reform efforts moving forward. And so we're placing, for example, a literacy coordinator in every prison. A fully accredited teacher who's a specialist in literacy will be in every prison to then train our long-term inmates to be literacy tutors. And then so we can expand the numbers of folks that we have in literacy training. There's so many are functionally illiterate. It's a really difficult problem. I'll just tell you that we could save money through, you have to either save money through reducing your population or you cut your program. There's two big places where you can save money, and I think it's just short-sighted to cut out our rehabilitative program for the reasons you've described. You've got to have a job. You've got to have at least enough education to maintain that job. You've got to have some kind of stable housing, and you've got to stay clean and sober. If you can do those things, they make it on the outside at a terrific rate. If you don't have those things, they fail at a terrific rate. So it's really not rocket science. We just need to continue, in my view, to invest in it and improve on what we're doing.
I think that sounds very sensible. Now, what happens when they're released? Determinant sentencing, they're out on the street. Maybe they didn't have the facilities to become literate or take care of their substance abuse problem in prison. Do we have enough community facilities so that people on a GPS system, for example, or under search and seizure are given a shot at getting what they couldn't get in prison?
The short answer is no, that we don't have enough community programs. And one of, I think, the early criticisms of the plan I've just laid out is that those offenders who are no longer going to be on parole, will they be eligible for parole program? And, the short answer in our proposal is no. Now, some of that is for good reason, in that if you're a low-risk offender, that means you're likely to make it on the outside without our intervention. And so we should be saving those dollars. For our moderate-risk offender, it gets a little more dicey. And again, our communities will be providing more services than they have before to help fill that gap, undoubtedly. Those people will still have needs. And I know they're getting cuts all the time, too. There are, though, programs that, if you're off parole, that you would be eligible for, that you're not if you're on parole. So, for example, our mentally ill offenders recidivate at an alarming rate. Very few can make it on the outside, if both on parole and mentally ill. They would be eligible for Prop 63 help, and they're not currently because of their parole status. So that's one area that we would see a small win.
Okay, there are interesting possibilities there. Another concern I have, though, is this basically a cost shift to counties, or are we planning to have, are we going to be giving any money to counties to deal with their new responsibilities?
We won't be mandating that the counties take on additional costs. There is, currently we pay the sheriffs, for example, the daily jail rate when they're holding one of our parolees and we've placed a hold on them. If they choose to keep that person in jail, then that'll be an additional cost. Frankly, what I'd like to see is, and what I believe on the service end, is that the state, with 115,000 parolees, we release 10,000 to the street every month, 3,000 in LA County alone every month. We will never have enough state-funded programs for that wave of offenders that leave our facilities every month. We've got to build a network of nonprofit, faith-based, community, state programs as a net for those. So one example is we've taken, in the past, we've had a few, five or six job placement coordination centers for our parolees. We're now investing that money into the workforce investment boards across the state to try to work within the existing networks more. I think we need to do more of that kind of thing. I just don't think we'll ever get there when you think about the volume of people that the state prison system releases every year.
Right. Well, thank you. Just finally, let me say if there's any states that you all know about that are doing it really well, so they're not having the recidivism problem and the huge expenses that we have in California, I would just like to know about it and what the things are that they're doing that work better. Because I think we all know we have to do it better, and we have to save money. We can't keep on like we are. But thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Huff, and then Senator Negrete McLeod.
Thank you. Secretary Kate, a couple of things. Following up on my colleague, I was actually going to ask about GPS, and I'll have some clarifying questions on that as well. I think overall you've tackled your challenges in an innovative way to minimize state costs. I do see it may have some more trial costs at the county. If right now we can bust them directly from parole back to prison if they're violating parole, is that the way it works?
No, typically they'll spend at least a little bit of time in a county jail, we have in some circumstances done what we call direct entry into a prison, but that's pretty rare.
Okay. In those cases, it would obviously cost more to go through a jury trial than get back into prison rather than the do not pass go scenario. As far as the community supervision, I that also gives me some sense of what's the right word I'm looking for? It helps alleviate the concerns I would have about having, the back out on the street in a new way without direct supervision. And I guess I don't share the concern of Assemblyman Arambula in that arena. Because if they're not offending, if they're not doing anything that they shouldn't be doing, then they're not going to go back, as you said. However, if they are we somehow as a state just supposed to look the other direction so that they're not coming back into prison? I mean, I don't think that makes sense. Ultimately, the safety of the citizens is the most important aspect to that degree. On the GPS, it does seem to be a way that we have been able to use technology to our advantage to hopefully help lessen some costs. But could you speak a little bit to what is the scope of GPS devices in use, and how is that program working? How is the effectiveness of it?
Joyce, maybe you can help me if you know the exact numbers of. Off the top of my head, I think we have five or six pilots at 20 offenders each throughout the state. We work with DOJ on those, with local sheriffs, with task forces. Typically on high gang urban task forces, and they use this to identify those who are gang leaders, high-risk folks that are on parole. The state picks up most of the tab for that, and we're not budgeted for it. But again, as a pilot, it was deemed a good investment to try to see if we can interdict some crime through the use of these. Right now, the pilot has 20-to-1 ratios on more of this active caseload. That's where the most of the cost comes in, is lowering those caseloads from 70-to-1 to 20-to-1 is very expensive. If you've already made up your mind that you're going to go to 40-to-1 or 45-to-1 or whatever it may be, then just the cost of the GPS is relatively negligible as compared to the cost of the agent.
If you have five or six pilots of 20 each, then you've got 100 to 120 of these things in use. So you're talking about a pretty large-scale expansion of what you're currently doing, correct?
Maybe finance can correct me.
Yeah, Justin Howard, Department of Finance. The department in addition to these pilots for the gang offenders, have approximately 6,000 to 7,000 GPS units on active sex offenders throughout the state. So they have a really well-run program right now as it relates to GPS units and training for agents. High-risk sex offenders are already monitored at a 20-to-1 ratio level, and the non-high-risk sex offenders are at a 40-to-1. So it ramping up to this additional level of GPS units should be well within their abilities.
Okay, so this is an expansion from sex offenders, violent or high-risk sex offenders, to the rest of the prison population coming out of prisons.
Mr. Howard's right in that we now have every sex offender in California strapped with a GPS device. This would expand. It may be 7,000. I thought it was a little more than that, but the idea would be that this wouldn't be, we're not going to expand to put everyone on GPS as they come out of prison. Again, we have between 110 and 120,000 releases a year. So out of that, we're talking about a little less than 2% would be on, 2% more than are currently on now would be on these. And we would just look again, I'd like to leave a little bit of discretion for the agents in the field and the parole administrators to work with law enforcement and say which neighborhoods are your citizens at greatest risk, which gangs are giving you the most problems, and again use this as a tool to interdict those most at-risk communities, which tend to be urban, poor communities. And so it's something that I can tell you our law enforcement partners are absolutely loving. And again, it's a way to try to help them in the jobs they're doing with our serious offenders, and we fund it by doing less on our low-risk and non-serious offenders.
As I recall, there's a bill percolating through the system here that would put some teeth or some consequences into illegally removing a GPS device or doing something like that. Is that a problem? Are they taking these things off, or can they take them off without detection, or are there consequences built in the system?
Are you familiar with the bill?
Yeah, I'm familiar with the bill. Right now, in terms of our GPS units, anybody who tampers with a GPS unit obviously is subject to violation of parole. So we already have the ability to place someone into prison up to a year. The bill that's going through the legislature obviously would give it another tool for all of our local law enforcement folks, as well as us, for convictions.
And I don't know the rate at which we have tampering problems.
That'd be helpful to know, actually. Okay. But thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Negrete McLeod, and then Assemblyman Cook.
I just had a vision of people in chains in a boat, you know, with the GPS stuff. So, but anyway, the parole stuff, is it legislatively mandated to you, or how did you come up with this thing that after they come out of prison, they're similarly put onto a 3-year parole?
It is. It's legislative, statutorily mandated.
Okay. That's all I want to know.
Okay. Assemblyman Cook.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. First of all, I want to thank you for your presentation today, and I also am concerned about these issues, a strong supporter of the GPS and technology, and I appreciate your advances in that area. I'm a little concerned about the overall bureaucracy or this, you know, we're talking the policy of what we're going to do and everything else, but right now it's how we're going to, you know, shave off all that money. And some of us older people, myself, I was in the military many years ago, and we had a series of what were called reduction in forces, where you just had to trim your budget and personnel and everything like that. And I always found, maybe when I was a lieutenant, I wasn't riffed, as the phrase went, but I was always thought that there were too many colonels running around the Marine Corps, and obviously not enough PFCs, sergeants, and lieutenants. And then my perspective changed, of course, when I made colonel, in that maybe there weren't enough. But my question basically is, I want to see if you've taken a look at the overall bureaucracy, because I really think in what you do, You need those boots on the ground. You know, that is so, so important in all aspects, both in the prisons and rehab and everything like that. And I want to make sure that some of these issues are going to be controversial on how we decide them, but in terms of overall structure, that you've examined to make sure that at the top we don't have too many, quote, colonels running around bumping into each other. Not that they would ever do that. And I know you were the IG one time, and I was an IG. And I have to admit, I used to count the number of colonels in an organization when I came in there, and then I'd take a look at the sergeants, the corporals, and the PFCs, because they're the ones that are down there in the trenches getting work done. So if you could comment on, in terms of the reduction in force at top, where there are certain essential people, maybe not at the bottom, but in the trenches that really, really carry out the mission. So if you could comment on that, please, I'd appreciate it.
Sure. You know, if you go section by section in any department and ask whether they're, you know, they have too many people, the answer is always no. In fact, they always are saying that they need 5% more people to get their job done. They can't possibly live without everyone they have. Some of the difficulties that I've discovered is that the department has really had a difficult time understanding just where it could cut, because it was so a paper-based organization for way too long. And so only this year we're introducing truly a business information system technology that will allow us to really get a handle on reconciling our positions to a person, understanding how much we're spending at the time we're spending it instead of several months later. I could have Mr. Lewis give you chapter and verse on his first year struggles as in trying to get a handle on our budget. The department, as I found it, through, I think, really a lack of investment in largely in IT and maybe just putting out fires after fire and not having enough time to address these issues, really struggled with its budget and with its position reconciliation. And so we've started no less than 5 separate internal audits to try to get a handle on just those things you've described. At 68,000 employees, those take some time to do correctly. If we were in private enterprise, we'd be a Fortune 100 company. And so it takes some time, but we've launched a number of those. So that's a long way of saying I can't tell you that we're as lean as we should be yet. So what we did on headquarters is just say we need to take a 5% unallocated cut of headquarters as a starting point, just to have kind of enough credibility to sit here before you and talk about this, cutting staff in the field, for example. And so we've taken on that. We're going to cut at least 200 positions from headquarters as a starter. I have no doubt that we need to reduce our operating expenditures as well. We're going through every lease right now to see if there's additional space that we can cut. All those things are happening all at the same time that we're trying to get this done. The other thing that we have to keep in mind is that we have 19 class actions, and so many headquarters positions came as a result of court orders that you will have this team. You will have a team that does that and a team that does the other thing. And so the long-range solution is to try to take back control of the department and give it to state government where it belongs. And so we're taking a much more aggressive approach in trying to handle our friends in the federal courts and saying that we can handle our business if you'll let us try. So we'll continue to reduce our headquarters budget. We'll continue to reduce our OE&E expenses. I really thank Mr. Lewis and the Department of Finance for doing that. I have no doubt that our friends, whether they be in the stakeholders in the communities or in labor or in this building or in the federal courts, we'll be pointing out areas where we could save other than in the area that they would like to remain. And so we'll go through that process undoubtedly kind of all summer long. But I think that's good for us. It's a big, unwieldy organization still. And the more that we can look at ourselves and kind of be transparent about our flaws, the more we can the more of that fat we can cut. I just have been really appreciative of the fact that people have been understanding to this point that we're trying to get a handle on it, and we have so many conflicting orders from so many different groups to try to accomplish. We'll get there, but I can't sit here and say we're there yet.
Thank you, Assemblyman. Assemblyman Jeffries.
You made mention of putting out fires, which brought up an issue for me that is a little off topic, but related to CAL FIRE's proposing to close 11 of your conservation camps, or their conservation camps, which has got to impact probably 1,000 or 1,500 inmates, I would imagine. Are you going to go ahead and close those camps with them and roll all those inmates back into other facilities along with all the employees, or are you going to try and create some sort of CDCR hand crews without CAL FIRE? I mean, they are a valuable resource to the state. I mean, what do you envision is going to happen there?
Boy, that's a great question, and one I'm not terribly prepared to answer. The fire crews are of great value to the department. It's a terrific training ground for inmates, and it provides a valuable service to the community. So I'm probably speaking out of class here by saying I hope that doesn't happen. We actually have too many beds for our low-level offenders. So between our community correctional facilities, our fire camps, our minimum security facilities, those one, level one and two kind of offenders, we actually have empty beds for those kind of offenders. Whereas we are stuffed to the gills and crowding to the about to burst in our reception centers because of the churning, and in our level three and four facilities with our higher level offenders. So it's an interesting problem. We probably could get more efficient in our low level beds, but coming at the expense of the fire camps would be a hard blow. I recognize it may be that's what the administration has to do because of the economy. That would be a tough day for corrections.
I know some of my colleagues have additional questions. I wanted to return to the numbers here yet again, because that's not something we can overlook. So wanted to see if you could offer some, even in general terms, further ideas as how you think we're going to get from 315 to 400 million. And maybe we just take it segment by segment. Of course, the biggest chunk is in parole reform. So if in a so-called perfect world there would be 3 years of search and seizure for those no longer on parole, what would be the additional savings if we couldn't afford that perfect world and had to make it 2 years?
I don't know. David?
We didn't account for any cost associated with the three-year search and seizure, so there would be no impact from adjusting that tail.
Nothing whatsoever. No. So given that that is $178.5 million in 2009, what other adjustments to the parole reform proposal could we consider which would get it, let's say, over 200 or 210? How do we squeeze a little bit more?
Well, there's okay, if we want to talk about what could happen,
yes.
You could not have.
Because we need to be thinking about what could happen, because we have to get to 400 million.
The interesting thing about this is that it's not wholly science based. So, for example, there are low risk offenders among the serious violent and sex offenders, if you talk to parole agents, they'll tell you they'll take, 20 people who have been in prison for 25 years for murder over one heroin addict as far as the amount of trouble that they cause in their caseload. But I just don't think as an administration, we're not ready to say that just because you're low risk, we're not going to have you on parole. If you've committed a serious violent or sex offense, we kind of set the parole risk assessment aside and say we've just got to have supervision on you. We're just not comfortable going there. You could add the high risk.
But, and again, just let me put that in the context. Even though in any other state, once you served your time, the state wouldn't be bothering with parole anyway, no matter what.
In some other states, that's true. And you could put your high risk offenders in this category and not have them on parole. But again, it's, you know, you will have additional costs associated with the crime in the communities. I think, as I said, we could enhance the credit enhancements from a 5-week cap to a 6-week cap or a 7-week cap. The problem is under state law, most of those, you know, you only have 50% of your offenders who are really eligible for that. And they serve the shortest periods of time. And so you get diminishing returns with that group as you give them more opportunities for credit. It's a fine idea. And as we were talking as we were walking over about trying to give credits for
participation.
We've talked about that too, but giving credits for college accomplishments, which we hadn't accounted for here, and say if you get your associate's degree, maybe that's worth additional credits. So those are things we can do around the edges that aren't worth a terribly large amount of money. The other one is that you can deal with the issue of we have right now 40-1. And if we went to 45-1, I don't know, what do you remember what that's worth, David?
It was worth
about $16 million for 45-1.
Again, some room there to have a discussion about that. I would just hate for us to get to the point, though, where we're really no longer providing that the social work component of this job. And I really want to get us to the place where an agent is required to know every drug and alcohol program, every mom and pop job placement program, every priest with a soft heart, all those kinds of things in their community to try to build that network. And we've got to keep caseloads low to expect that.
Very good. I don't mean to put you on the spot, but at the same time, it's a little frustrating for us that out of a approximately $10 billion general fund budget, we're stuck at about 3% when we're seeing so many other very critical services state government being told consider 10, 15, 20%. And I think we would all agree that the best crime prevention program that we have is investing appropriately and successfully in education. But we're telling education to take deeper cuts than corrections. It almost sounds completely backwards. Senator Hancock, you had another question.
This is a follow-up on some of the other questions and really goes back to the how do we get to $400 million. But one of the things that had been suggested was what they're calling compassionate release, but I guess is translated as when guys get to a certain age, they don't seem to offend anymore. Do you let the people, treat the people over 50 differently? What about the people who are 80 and in wheelchairs? At what point is it, there are other places for them to be that aren't as expensive and don't take the beds that are needed for other people in our prisons?
I think we're open to those kinds of ideas. My impression after a year is that the compassionate release program currently in state law doesn't work. It has to go from the warden to the director of adult operations. If she approves it, it goes to the board of parole hearings. If they approve it, it goes to a county, the judge who sentenced the person. And what we're seeing now is for our most ill inmates, Superior Court judges are refusing, not because they're a risk to the community, but because the community doesn't want the additional costs associated with caring for that person on their dime. So it's not very effective. There's some opportunities there perhaps to do more of that. I've been talking to the receiver about medical parole and some possibilities associated with that, paroling someone to a medical facility that is low risk to the community and ideas like that. The receiver and I have also been talking about reintegrating the medical care back into the department and removing some of the redundancies. You know, we have two budget departments, two legal departments, all those kinds of things. So if we can continue to work on that relationship, there's some savings we might generate from that. You know, those are I think all those are good things to explore.
Great. Thank you. And then the other question was really following up on some questions of Assemblyman Cook, and that is about the headquarters position reductions. So if there are 68,000 employees of the department, which is huge, it's like a small city, how many are in headquarters?
So out of the 68,000, about 3,000 are here in, you know, in the greater Sacramento headquarters area, and another 1,000 are in the regions, regional accounting and those kinds of things. So taking the term headquarters in its broadest sense, meaning administrators kind of statewide, you're talking about 4,000.
Okay. And you say here 180 positions would be eliminated, and then you talked about 200 later. Is that like 200 additional ones?
I just know that, as again, before on our way in, I said that our headquarters reduction team had found 200 that they could eliminate thus far. So, which again, I just had laid out a mandate that go find 5% as a starting point. And so we've found those 200 positions to eliminate in headquarters statewide. That doesn't mean our work is done, obviously, but that's where we're at so far.
Okay, and then finally, what about overtime? This can sort of be the third rail of a lot of this discussion, but really it's talked about all the time informally by people as being a huge cost. I don't know what it is in total millions of dollars. Maybe you know, but how we deal with that.
Sure, let me frame it and then I'll have Mr. Lewis talk a little bit about it in detail. But the department, I think, was rightly criticized for its overtime expenditures. Some of that was that we just didn't plan well enough as far as holding academies, and so we found ourselves really short on correctional officers. And so we were having to hold officers over, literally not letting them go home and having them serve double shifts, which the officers didn't like, and they were very concerned about it. They earned large paychecks, but didn't have time for family and for really a healthy lifestyle. So we've filled our correctional officer positions for the most part. So that's one piece of it. And that's helped. I think we've also done a better job of working with our employees on a better use of sick leave. And some of that is again, when you're not ordering people over as much, they don't feel the need to call in sick to get the day off to be able to attend their kid's birthday or those kinds of things. Or go to that doctor's appointment or whatever it may be. Anyway, so we're seeing, I think, the numbers come down. Maybe Mr. Lewis, you can describe where we're at.
At this point this year, for overtime that the department controls, which excludes medical guarding and medical transportation, which is controlled by the receiver, we anticipate in spending around $190 million, which may go up slightly because we haven't been holding academies, so our vacancies have been creeping up as we anticipate these reductions, and we don't want to have to lay off staff. That's a reduction from about $320 million in the previous fiscal year and over $400 million in the fiscal year before that. So we've steadily been reducing overtime over the last few years. We still, as the Secretary said, we still have some areas we need to address. We still have a lot of information gathering that needs to happen. Traditionally, there's been a lot of mixing and matching of, for example, we've had over 200 overtime codes that things could be coded to in the past. And in order to have a system that is truly accountable, you have to have some simplicity to it that can be understood by the layperson who's actually controlling things. So we're getting a better handle on exactly what is causing the overtime. At this time, most of our overtime costs that we control are driven still by sick leave use, but other things such as emergencies, we still have some vacant positions in various areas are driving costs, but we're certainly working on identifying all those things and working to become the most efficient possible so that we ensure, for example, sick leave is one where you have variable costs on a daily basis that you need to account for as you budget positions.
Now, do you budget a certain amount for sick leave every year?
That's one of the things that we need to work on is addressing how much sick leave overtime needs to be budgeted. Right now, we only have positions budgeted for sick leave coverage, but due to the variable nature of sick leave, that may not be the most appropriate way to budget. So that's one of the things that we are working on right now to ensure that we do it the most efficient way possible.
Okay, because if we have to take money from other parts of the corrections budget, if there's more sick leave or overtime than we anticipated, that would mean that certain other critical things wouldn't get done, which would be a concern, especially if there were things related to getting people the treatment or the education that they need to make it outside the prison. Would you recommend that we try to really firewall various parts of the budget?
Well, over the last couple of years, prior to approximately 5 years ago, all institutional costs, with the exception of health care, were budgeted in the same item. Those institutional costs related to program are now budgeted in a separate item, so there's some accountability there. There's also provisional language that's been in our budget for the last 4 years that requires us to revert unspent money on certain items to the general fund. And last year, unfortunately, due to the overrun, we did have to request to retain that funding. But there are some firewalls that exist right now. Our hope is we're working on several different fronts to really true up our budget and ensure that there's some accountability in those things so that we can ensure that as we come forward that there's no sense that that there's no accountability for those.
Thank you.
Chairman Arambula, and then we will move to public comment.
Thank you, Chairman Leno. First, let me say, Mr. Secretary, I have always enjoyed working with you. I have a high level of respect and regard for you and your professionalism, going back to when you were Inspector General. And your staff has been excellent to work with. I do have some concerns, though, regarding the costs, and I'd like to go back to them just briefly. Your proposal indicates that there will be a certain level of savings, but there are also some new costs. I assume the savings are net savings after these additional costs. Would you run down for us what those new costs are? For example, the enhancing the parole agent ratios, the purchase and operation of the GPS systems, and staff increases. It seems like, I know sometimes you have to spend money to make money, or in this case, spend money to save money, but give us some idea of the order of magnitude of these new costs.
Sure, I'd be happy to. And I'd invite Ms. Hayhoe or Mr. Lewis to correct me if I go afield here of these of where our numbers are at, or my friends from the Department of Finance. I would say this by way of background, though. The previous proposal where we just said, serious violent sex offenders on, non-serious non-violent off, was worth considerably more than this. I think it was definitely north of 400 the first year. My concern was it just didn't fly. It didn't happen. And so we didn't get the reforms that we need. And that led us to rethink it. And so that's kind of what drove the process. I just say that for context as we talk about these costs. The biggest driver of additional costs is the increased parole supervision. That is 650 positions, parole agent jobs, that would be saved by increasing the supervision, and that costs about $85 million. The additional fugitive apprehension team members, 37 of those is about $5 million. The passive GPS units that I described, 2,000 passive GPS units, $5.6 million. And then there's about $10 million in additional program completion coordinators and case records analysts to do the math and to make sure that people are released on time based upon this new system of giving bonus credits for accomplishments by inmates in prisons. And as I said, that's about $10 million. Mr. Howard from Finance had noted to me that if you stage in those costs, you can bring them down a little bit, meaning if you phase them in. But it's also true now at this point in time that I'm sure our savings numbers are eroding because of the delays in implementation. So we're seeing that happen as well.
And I'd like to add, in addition to that, there would be a one-time offset during fiscal year 09-10 when we start to phase in these proposals and as we attrit down the number of staff. So, for example, on July 1st, when these proposals take place, we know that we're not going to be able to eliminate those positions immediately. So you're going to have a phase-in of the savings over that year, and you won't realize the full fiscal cost, full fiscal savings during that year. And so that's a one-time offset of roughly $30 million.
And does the figure that we have for savings reflect that offset?
Yes.
Okay. Now, one of the options that's available to us is what you have proposed. Another option could well be outside of our control in the form of an inmate reduction plan implemented or forced by the courts. If I recall right, that reduction would result in some 30 to 50,000 inmates being released. And confirm, if you would, the estimated savings, if that court order were to happen, would be approximately $1 billion in savings?
If you were to release 50,000 inmates, it would be a little over $1 billion. So, yes.
Okay. And going back to the proposal dealing with the parole reform, I'm still struggling with it. And I noticed that I understand that you have a legal opinion that gives you some assurance that such a proposal would withstand some judicial challenge through litigation. But we all know the department has been unfortunately subject to numerous litigation over the years. And, you know, prior to your arrival, Mr. Secretary, but, you know, it seems like the courts are slowly chipping away at our control of the department. I'm a little concerned that if we put our eggs in, you know, all of our eggs in one basket, in other words, if we say we want to save money, we're going to do it through parole reform, and it's contingent on the legality of this approach being upheld, that we may find ourselves in a position where we did not achieve the level of savings that that we're anticipating. But even more than that, that currently, if someone is, you know, serves their 13 months, you know, they serve their time in state prison. They then go on parole. Half of them get off of parole after 13 months. If they were to commit a new crime or before they could be subject to search and seizure, there would have to be some probable cause for law enforcement to go into their homes and do search and seizure. The folks that we're talking about putting on 36 months search and seizure are already by definition low-risk, nonviolent, non-sex offenders, and they have gone through the risk assessment that you're proposing to implement. But they would then lose their constitutional protection for an additional 23 months on top of or in addition to what they would be subject to. We're already one of the few states in the nation that places everyone on parole, and this proposal seems to be going in the wrong direction. And I guess I'm still at a loss as to why we would want to have folks under search and seizure for 36 months when half of them are only subject to search and seizure for 13 months. And whether that might present some additional liability or exposure in terms of a judicial challenge.
I think that you've laid out the issue fairly, and I think it's an issue that reasonable minds could probably differ on as far as what the best approach towards these offenders is. As you've said, for half of the folks that would be released from that we're proposing to release from parole, they would be subject to search and seizure for 3 years because they will have committed some kind of violation of parole during that first 13 months, and so it won't impact them at all, except that they won't be going back to prison for that technical violation as they would now. Again, for those folks, it stops the process of catch and release, as some newspapers have described it. This idea that the same offender is either in the sheriff's county jail or homeless or in our prison system, it's an opportunity to really stop that churn effect. For half of the offenders who are making it now, they would be subject, as you've described, to 23 additional months of search and seizure provisions, but those are the least likely to have a negative experience with law enforcement, in that those are the folks who have been shown to make it. So it really is simply a trade of some less supervision on the front end, the risk of being revoked on the front end being removed for a little longer period of supervision within your community. And I understand why it could trouble you, and I recognize that it is a trade-off to some measure, and reasonable minds may not agree that it's the right trade. But I will say this: in 5 years as the Inspector General and as the Secretary of this department, it's my experience that one thing corrections does well is stay the same. And I'm just really looking for a way to move us off of where we've been and get us going in a direction that's evidence-based, and that will start to bring the cost down, albeit not as much as we might like, but that has a chance of building some consensus. And that's really where my heart's at on this.
Thank you for your candor. I would just conclude, Mr. Chairman, by pointing out that a crisis is a terrible thing to waste, and this may be a perfectly good opportunity to revisit some of the operations that in prior years we would not have dared touch because of the politics surrounding it. So I would encourage us to put on our thinking caps and look for ways that make sense and save money. I think we can maintain or increase public safety and save money at the same time.
I agree.
Thank you. I think we have one additional question before we move to public comment.
Thank you. And Mr. Chairman, I'd like you to just hear me out and then respond. Or I'm sorry, Mr. Secretary, as we discussed this some time ago, and I think you came to me recognizing myself and my colleagues are very concerned about how this is going to be interpreted by the public as in terms of their safety. And on the one hand, you have a period or a group of prisoners who are coming back into the community. We know they're all coming back in the community, but you've deemed them to be less serious offenders, and you're offering them a trade. We won't have you on any kind of parole at all, but we will have this 3-year period of search and seizure. That allows you on the other side of the a column for the more serious offender, where we'd like to have a much better idea what's going on, to have 40-to-1 ratios for the sexual and violent offender that's coming out. Again, either way, we can't keep them in jail any longer. They've served their time. As I think I told you in that meeting, That sounds pretty good. From a peace officer's perspective, you're going to have a better handle on the serious offender. You know, when you suspect the guy's a burglar again and you can search his car, that helps. And it changes the dynamic from one parole agent who would never be seeing this guy ever, or maybe very rarely, to every peace officer in the state of California having the ability to protect the citizens by searching and seizing when he finds them. And let's be honest, he's not going to stop and search and seize everybody he runs into. He's still going to have some cause. He might even have enough cause to do it without this provision. Something's going to cause him to want to check this guy's car, house, bedroom, whatever. With all due respect to Mr. Rambula's concerns, I think that that may be a decent trade-off. However, it's going to be difficult for me to sell to my constituents that we're taking 40% of these prisoners and we're eliminating parole. And I think we ought to have 5 years instead of 3 years of search and seizure in exchange. It is a balance. It is a compromise. But I think that it is innovative, and I think that as I've expressed that concern to you in the past, we need this at a minimum, I believe, to satiate the concerns of people who would be looking at this as a way that we're releasing people early. Your comment?
Well, I think that, as I said before, reasonable minds can differ on this point. I think you've just aptly, cogently described the counterpoint to what Assemblyman Arambula has described, concerns on the civil liberties side of this and the costs associated with that locally. It certainly is, there are certainly two sides of this, and eventually this is, I just am happy that we're having this kind of discussion publicly. I think it's exactly what policymakers in California should be deciding, exactly those kinds of points, is where do we land on issues just like this. And anything the department or the administration could do going forward to try to assist this body in deciding where to draw those lines in cooperation with the administration, we're ready to do that.
Senator.
I think legislators who talk about their constituency, you know, a whole lot of us come from constituencies that have people that have served time in jail. We don't have constituency who's never gone to jail like your district.
I wish
But in some districts, you know, we hear from constituents how they feel, how unfair that once somebody has served their time and they come back and they have to do parole, they've served their time, they've paid. We have asked these people, we as legislators say, this is what you must do once you commit a crime. And these people do it. And then suddenly we're saying, and in addition to serving your time, now you must do A, B, C, D, all the way to Z. And at some point, what kind of a society are we that we want the people that have served their time to continue for the rest of their life to serve their time? And that's what we as legislators have done. We stigmatized them. Yes, they've served their time. Yes, they've been bad people. But at some time, as Ms. Hancock said, the crimes, and we all know that the crimes are caused in an age group like this. Once they reach a certain age group, very few people are going to commit crimes. We know that. So at what point do we stop being punishers for the rest of someone's life?
Thank you, Senator. I appreciate everyone's participation. Thank you for answering our questions. We're going to ask the public to step forward and share any thoughts, concerns, brilliant ideas and suggestions you all have so that we can reach that $400 million mark.
Good morning. Craig Brown, California Correctional Peace Officers Association. There's just a couple issues I want to cover very quickly and then talk about parole. During the response to Mr. Jeffrey's point, the secretary pointed out that he had a large number of low-level vacant beds in California. We'd suggest that you can save a ton of money if you take those out-of-state beds that you're paying full dollar on, that you're spending excessive amounts of money getting inmates screened and shipped to these out-of-state beds and put them back in those low-level beds that are now sitting vacant and unused. No impact on public safety, brings more jobs to California, takes them away from out-of-state, and will save you a ton of money. Suggestion one. Suggestion two, headquarters. The Assembly Accountability Committee, it has a longer name than that, had a hearing on this issue and talked about 1,500 vacancies in headquarters, 1,500 budgeted vacant positions. I think you've been offered somewhere around 200. Seems to me that everybody can keep working, can keep doing what they're doing, and you can save a whole lot more money simply by sweeping vacancies. Again, that may change. I watched the hearing. I didn't do the research. Point three on overtime. That was a really good question. Our members would love to see overtime come down. The best way to get overtime down is be fully staffed. They're not fully staffed. It's far cheaper to have a new correctional officer working at $3,000 or $3,500 a month than it is to have some senior officer making overtime. The thing I do want to spend a minute on is parole. Let's go back and take the big picture look. Okay, who comes to prison? 20% of convicted felons. 80% of convicted felons aren't in the system. So these low-risk people that you're talking about are certainly low-risk to corrections. They're the lowest risk they have. They're not low-risk to the public. The 80% that aren't convicted felons that aren't in your system are your low-risk offenders. Some of those may not even be low-risk if you talk to your probation departments. But let's look at them. They're all getting out. What parole does for people getting out is try to make them succeed first. You're going to, anybody you do on whatever you're calling this new category, community supervision, are not going to get that help. They're not going to be able to go to their parole agent and ask for a bus pass. They're not going to be able to go to a parole agent and say, I've got a job, I need some tools. They're not going to be able to go to a parole agent for drug treatment. They're not going to be able to go to a parole agent for housing help. You're going to take these people. They were unprepared when they came to prison. They are unprepared when they leave prison. And you're going to assume that they somehow disappear. The system is based on the fact, the budget estimate is based on the fact they don't come back to the system. Well, let me tell you, they're coming back. They aren't getting the help they need. These people, again, undereducated with a criminal record and $200 in their pocket. You can call them parolees and bring them back one way. You can leave them out there with help and bring them back through the courts. The courts will incur costs, and they'll come back with a heck of a longer sentence. So you need to think about how you want to deal with these as human beings, not as a label. And the fact is, Daryl Steinberg did Prop 63 for one reason. One major reason was he needed a case manager. The mental health person in the community needed somebody to link them up with the available services. Parole agents do that job for releasees. If you don't have that, rest assured, you might get a short-term savings. You're getting them back with a whole lot longer sentences. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Brown.
Helen Roth-Dowden from Service Employees International Union. We represent a lot of the teachers, the cooks, the people that make the non-correctional staff in the prisons. And I think what we've found that education really works in making a change. Some recent data that we've looked at shows for every dollar you spend on rehabilitation, you save $250. And as the former speaker said, a lot of the people who come in are undereducated when we come in, and they go out undereducated. Now we only have about 14% of the population is in any sort of education classes, and we really want to see that increased. In the book that I passed out, you'll see in the back solutions that we've come up with. These are solutions are based on talking to workers and asking them what they think would work since they work with the prisoners every day. And so these are some simple things that we think you could do. We were very We heard the talk about education here, but our members received layoff notices this weekend. So we're not sure on one hand while we're talking about this. On the other hand, teachers are receiving layoff notices. So we wanted to bring that to your attention. Also, we're concerned whenever you do these early release, it's going to mean additional clerical staff. And I had heard that you are counting some of this cost in. But whenever you do these transfers or anything, you're talking about massive records. Most of it is not computerized, which means it's a very lengthy process even to get people out into these other programs. So I suggest we certainly want to work on this. We back many of the programs that you've brought up. We are for early release and for many other parole reforms, and look forward to working with this group. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members. I'm Tom Renfrey with the County Alcohol and Drug Program Administrators. And Secretary Cade had mentioned in his report that at least 50% of prison inmates have serious alcohol or other drug addictions. If you, you know, factor in those that have abused drugs, you're probably talking more like 70%, something, you know, higher. But the Secretary, when he was the Inspector General a few years ago, he wrote a report that was fairly critical of the in-custody drug treatment programs. The evidence shows that community-based drug treatment is much more effective in terms of reentry, reintegration into the community, reducing recidivism, and it's also much less costly. So one suggestion that we would have would be to maybe reconsider or consider some spending reprioritization to put more resources into SB 1453 type programs for community-based alcohol and drug treatment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Renfrey.
Could you say what SB 1453, whatever, because some of us aren't familiar with anybody.
It was a bill a couple of years ago by Senator Speer, maybe two or three years ago, that provided for programs in the community once prisoners are released and that have had some treatment in custody that they would then be shifted into guaranteed treatment in the community for a period of time following their release.
So what happened to that bill?
If I could, Senate Bill 1453 was implemented by the Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation. It requires that if someone is enrolled in a drug treatment program in the facility, that they can mandatorily go to aftercare for up to 150 days. If they successfully complete aftercare, they're discharged from parole. And that is has been implemented, and we're carrying that out right now within the department.
Do you know what the budget item is? It's fully funded.
It is fully funded. And we make adjustments to this program twice a year through their population based upon the actual number of individuals who complete in-prison drug treatment and the number of individuals. Those individuals are then guaranteed a slot in aftercare. So we ensure full funding for this program.
Okay. Do we have data on recidivism?
We do. I think we just completed a report to the legislature. I'll get a copy for all the members present here today.
Thank you, Ms. Hayhoe.
We would love to see that program expanded. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Renfrey.
Mr. Chairman, members, Helene Meshar, representing the California Association of Alcohol and Drug Program Executives. We are the nonprofit community-based treatment programs that actually provide the treatment. We would like to just mention that untreated substance abuse is a major cost driver for both the criminal justice system and the healthcare system, and that an expansion of both in-custody treatment with community follow-up and community aftercare with dollars following those people out of prison is one of the best ways to prevent recidivism and to drive down the costs of treatment. We know that the more people are in treatment and the longer that they're in treatment, the more successful they are. One of the conditions for completion of treatment, either be it 90 days or 90 or 6 months, is completion of a GED. We highly recommend and see to it that people who are in treatment receive both the education and beginning of job training and vocational training in treatment. So we would hope that you would look at treatment as a first step out of the criminal justice system into the rehabilitation part of CDCR. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, Mr. Secretary, Mr. Chairman, members. Nick Warner on behalf of the California State Sheriff's Association. I'd just like to briefly focus on some of the local impacts of this proposal. 34,500 prison inmates will be released without a parole term. Under current law, somewhere between 50% and 65% of this population can be expected to recidivate back to jail and prison. So if we take 34,500 off parole, we eliminate technical violators, which of course will bring down those numbers. We should still expect a significant number of these former parolees to come back to county jails. Proposed statutory changes to authorize search and seizure terms, it does make this proposal markedly better, in our opinion. It also does have a large impact on local law enforcement and county jails. Many or most jails are overcrowded now. We have 32 counties that are under court-imposed population caps, and we do expect this proposal will result in increased demand for service from DAs, public defenders, probation, police agencies, and sheriff agencies, and then again further exacerbate, to some degree, jail overcrowding. I'd also ask that you consider this proposal in context of several other proposals that are floating around the legislature in some form or another. One is the AOC is currently proposing to close courts 12 days per year, 1 day per month. That will have a significant impact in further backing up the jail system, the court system, keeping people in jail longer because we can't arraign them if the courts are closed. So that really is material to this conversation as well. Also, the governor's doomsday, as some have called it, proposal to shift wobblers and felons back to county jails will have a huge impact on county jail populations. CDCR estimates savings at $100 million. That's obviously cost to locals of $100 million. Also, the governor's doomsday budget proposal has a shift of Proposition 1A, the original Proposition 1A, which is $2 billion from local governments. Those of you on the committee who have served in local government and pay attention to these matters know that depending on the city or county, you can expect between 40 and roughly 55% of those dollars go to public safety agencies in some form or another, and that's going to have a huge impact on our ability to respond and to deal with this proposal. We do agree with the premise of the proposal, and I want to be very clear on that. Limited resources need to be deployed to those that pose the most significant danger to society, and we do recognize and support that premise. We stand ready to work with all parties involved. And I'll just close by saying, while the proposal, far from perfect, not quite good, is markedly better than anything we've seen before, again, we stand ready to work with all involved. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your comments, Mr. Warner.
Mr. Chairman and members, Francisco Labacco on behalf of the American Civil Liberties Union, and I just want to touch briefly on the search provisions of the proposal. We do view them as constitutionally troubling. The idea that you can engage in suspicionless searches of folks no longer under state supervision, parole or probation, is going to be subject to challenge undoubtedly. We are unaware of situations where ex-offenders, simply because you're an ex-offender, you lose your Fourth Amendment rights, which is what the consequences of this policy is. As you're aware, U.S. Supreme Court has permitted suspicionless searches of parolees, but so part of the rationale is that it's part of reintegration into society. If you're no longer going to provide supervision or parole guidance to these folks, then part of that rationale disappears. Finally, on the issue of I think what Mr. Arambula was speaking to. There may be some ex post facto issues here, because these folks are initially convicted of these crimes. Under current law, you're only permitted to be, as is indicated, on parole for a year. Absent good cause, you can be extended for 2 years. Whether you can, leaving aside the Fourth Amendment concerns, whether you could extend this provision to those folks who will no longer be on parole after 13 months is also another constitutional concern. So, and finally, these are policy questions, as best indicated. These aren't fiscal issues. So whether they should be taken up as part of a fiscal and trying to save corrections money is another consideration for you to take.
If I may, Mr. Lobacco, because of course this is going to be a very important part of our conversation, as Senator Benoit had stated in his earliest comments. With regard to what courts have sustained in limiting felons' constitutional rights, their right to vote, their right to bear arms, how would this be any different?
Well, it's interesting because a case came down in Indiana very recently this year, raised that question. And the court said, well, you know, Fourth Amendment rights are different. The ability to search your home, to search your cars, is a different constitutional protection. The simple fact that you were an ex-offender does not mean, and assuming you're no longer under parole or probation, does not mean you waive those Fourth Amendment rights. So if you proceed this route, I think it, as Mr. Arambula and others have indicated, it will be an interesting legal question for the courts to decide. And the implications are enormous, as you can understand, in terms of the logic of the proposal.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair and members. My name is Jim Lindbergh, and I'm speaking on behalf of the Friends Committee on Legislation of California. I want to echo the civil liberties concerns conveyed by Mr. Lobacco, and I would like to say it was really refreshing to hear the Secretary acknowledge that it would be short-sighted to cut programs in a budget crisis, and that cuts do need to come from population reductions. Having said that, we think that maybe the opportunity has come for the legislature to revisit AB 900 as a result of the tentative ruling by federal courts, which seems to be certain to be followed through with a ruling that CDCR must reduce the population significantly, and also in light of the governor's budget proposals, which order similar numbers of population reductions. When AB 900 was first passed, we informally estimated the cost of new beds at $288,000 per bed, and we did this just by taking the total number of money provided for new bed construction and dividing it by the number of new beds. Well, as I'm sure you are aware, the LAO report that just came out last week indicates now that we're going to be building about half the number of beds originally proposed under AB 900. They estimate the cost now at about $300,000 per bed, and that's not including the debt service interest and so forth on the bonds. So that's if previous bond issues are any barometer, we think we're looking at about $600,000 per bed when you include the interest and the debt service. That's phenomenal. That's a lot of teachers' salaries. That's a lot of law enforcement salaries and so forth. So we think we have a real rare historical opportunity here and that we ought to take advantage of it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lindbergh.
Good morning. Karen Pank on behalf of the Chief Probation Officers of California. And I know you guys have been struggling here today with a very difficult question on how to deal with limited resources. And we view the proposal through those eyes and want to just bring to bear a few things related to that as it relates to the locals, and that we can't look at this in a vacuum, and that there are a lot of other things affecting the locals right now, and this proposal would have some cost shifts to us specifically. And I won't go over some of the things I've been previously stated in earlier testimony, but that is a concern for us, as we are currently laying off peace officers in probation right now and closing parts of our institution and eliminating programs. So the thought of community supervision, it's in a desperate straits. But to that point, I want to end with just some positive notes and answer a couple of the questions that came up earlier in the testimony as to what do other states do, what can we be doing differently. And I want to applaud the legislature for, and Senate specifically just yesterday passed SB 678, a measure authored by Senator Leno and Senator Benoit, which looks at funding probation. All states but two, California is one of those, fund probation. And the reason that is important is that the legislature over the past couple of years have really focused on the immediate problem, understandably, of parole and how can we reform parole. But by doing so, it's an expensive question. It's a question that we're asking maybe a little bit too late in the system when we do have indications earlier in the system with these same people as to what might be needed to treat them cheaper, more efficiently, and have better success and outcomes. So we hope, as many people have testified here today, that there are some historic opportunities, that be one of them that we look at. We stand ready to continue to have the conversations. The administration, the secretary in particular, has been very good in briefing our people and trying to make sure that we know every step of the way what they're thinking. And in light of the many parole proposals that we have seen, this one truly is very thoughtful and we think has some good parts to it that we want to continue to work on throughout the process. So with that, I'll conclude my comments and thank you for your time.
Thank you, Ms. Pank.
Good morning, Mr. Chair and members. Secretary Kate, thank you for the opportunity. I'm Elizabeth Howard with the California State Association of Counties. Many of our concerns and perspectives have been shared by others who have come before me. I just wanted to mention that certainly we appreciate the gravity of the situation that is facing all of us in the corrections field, certainly, but in the broader context of a state budget gap that's almost unfathomable at this point. I think we need to consider these proposals in the context of the doomsday proposals that are before us. When we talk about potential early releases from the state prison system, although there may be no specific service expectations or mandated services that would be placed on counties, those folks will turn to someone, and in many cases it will be the counties. If some of the proposals that are on the table are ultimately carried out to close a tens of billions of dollars budget gap and we lose property taxes as one example, we're very concerned that our tattered safety net at the local level, beyond the law enforcement sectors who undoubtedly will face significant cuts, we won't have a service sector to provide mental health services, alcohol and drug. There potentially could be no Proposition 36 funding. So we know these are realities that you understand and appreciate, but just wanted to bring that to bear in the sort of the broadest context for counties. And we also thought we would put a plug in. We too are supportive of SB 678. For many years, counties have recognized the fact that probation is a linchpin in the criminal justice system, and we think an investment in that system can really help us stem some of the problems that we're facing in our collective correction system across both the state and local levels. Thank you for the opportunity to comment.
Thank you. Ms. Howard. Senator Benoit, you had a comment before you have to take off.
Yes, I'm sorry. I do have another conflict coming up, but I appreciate the comments of the, and I didn't mean to cut off public comment for early, but we've gone that way, sorry. I wanted to just briefly comment on a couple of things, that, particularly going back to Mr. Brown's comments, and ask the Secretary to consider a couple of thoughts. I think that we are, and the folks from the ACLU, I think we are looking at a serious court challenge. No question in my mind there will be challenges if this procedure were to go forward. And as we discussed sometime back, words do count in this process. I would like to think the courts wouldn't fall on semantics, but I think they're going to look at it very carefully. And I think that the idea that we would make a change like this might help to call it something a little different, like community parole instead of community supervision, or whatever the other term was. I think you said community supervision, yes. Because it is really a continuation of our parole process. It's a different type of parole than we are used to now, but it is still, I think, could be considered under the term parole of a different type, and that might help in sustaining the case later. And the other thing that I think is important is that Mr. Brown's point about those who get out and really want help, Would it be possible to make it possible under this community parole where they would be assigned a parole officer who has no responsibilities other than be available should they get a call from this individual asking for the bus pass, asking for whatever the services might be available to a parolee under existing parole requirements? I doubt many would, but I think that's a valid point that some might need that little bit of extra help. And in doing both of those things, I think you might sustain a better argument in front of the courts as to whether or not this person is still under some kind of parole that is legitimate under our existing statute and under their pre-existing sentence. Thoughts that I wanted to throw out there. And I thank you, and I'm sorry, I'm going to have to leave.
Very thoughtful comments. I'm sure we'll talk about them after you've left and after we've completed public comment.
Yes, chairs, my name is Jim Frayne, representing the California Coalition of Probation Organizations, Sacramento and Orange County Deputy Sheriffs, Anaheim Police Association. The people in this room, like Senator Leno and Juan, you spent hundreds of hours on this problem. And today the voters are deciding one of the linchpins to future budget problems with the state. We were talking about $400 million in savings to the Department of Corrections, but as you heard witnesses, Mr. Warner, the League of Cities and Counties testify, what is the cost to local government of that savings if they're attained of $400 million? Let me give you an example. Yesterday in Orange County, it was proposed of laying off 100 probation officers. Last week in Sacramento County, they're proposing on laying off 172 probation officers. What is going to happen when these parolees are released to local government without proper funding? Presently, public safety is overburdened. The number of patrol people on the streets, the caseloads of probation officers are 200. We're in a crisis. However, saving $400 million, the Legislative Analyst Office has proposed the Arizona plan. When these people are released from prison, the state saves a minimum of $49,000 per person. Is any of that money earmarked, as Mr. Warner said, for additional police officers, probation officers, public defenders, court personnel, judges, et cetera, unfortunately, no. Presently, California has an unemployment rate of plus 10%. In these economic times, are these persons that are being released going to find jobs out there? One of the things we've suggested in order to effectuate that, besides the educational program, is you give tax breaks to businesses to hire ex-felons to go to work. I commend Mr. Kate. Over the last couple of years, solutions are starting to bubble up, and maybe some of these programs should be pilot programs in large communities and small communities, and let's see what that brings in savings. But let's not throw the baby out with the bathwater to save $400 million. Thank you for your time.
Tax credit. Thank you, Mr. Frayne. So I think before we conclude, we might ask for your response to some of the ideas that have been brought forward through public comment.
I think just a few points. The only thing I would concern me about the out-of-state inmates is those are primarily level three inmates, and we do have we are facing a potential prisoner release order, and we had 20,000 what we call non-traditional beds in gyms and on day room floors, and the inmates that we've sent out of state have come from those beds, and so we've now reduced that number down to about 12,000, and so people are actually playing basketball in gyms instead of living in them now as a result. And so while it's true we can think creatively about how to handle our low-level beds, those out-of-state beds, it's not the same thing. As far as vacancies, as I mentioned earlier, we're doing a complete position reconciliation to determine what our real vacancy rate is. While undoubtedly At some point, we'll have to, as I've said, we'll continue to try to look for vacancies that we don't need. We look for positions that we can cut in headquarters. I think that's just good fiscal responsibility, and we're happy to do that.
Was that 1,500 number figure correct?
I don't think that may be on the book somewhere, but those aren't real. That's the problem that we found is that they don't match necessarily. The reconciliation is going on now. We'll know later this summer exactly how many there are, but I think that's overstated. The idea of providing some parole service to these offenders if they ask for it, I think has some merit, is worthy of discussion. The concern that we make sure that whatever this is, it can withstand constitutional muster, and how we phrase it, I think that's important. I recognize the concerns by the local law enforcement. I think those are well taken. It's just there's only so much we can do there. I think that I would conclude by saying that there have been some good points made both on the dais and at the lectern. And we stand ready to continue to work with policymakers in this body and both the Assembly and the Senate, as well as the stakeholders that have testified today, to try to get something that we can live with, that will move us forward.
Tell me if my math is correct. We're talking about this 34,000, 35,000 number of inmates. If we're releasing annually about 120,000 and a recidivism rate somewhere in the neighborhood of 65-70%, I guess our challenge is to identify those 30% who are not recidivating. And when you take 30% of 120,000, you're in the same ballpark. So that's our challenge, isn't it, to identify those who would not be coming back and release and identify those 35,000-40,000 as not required of parole.
Yes, that's right. And of course, we can never speak in absolutes when we're dealing with human beings. But we are looking at the offenders most likely to make it without parole supervision and spending less money on those offenders pocketing some of the savings and to try to deal with our deficit and maybe investing a little bit of it in the
community
on the high side. Yeah.
Yeah. Senator Hancock.
Thank you. I do have a couple of questions based on some of the specific comments that we heard that seemed like reasonable suggestions to me. One was Mr. Brown's comments on closing the out-of-state beds if we have empty 1 and 2 low-level beds in the state. Is that something you're considering?
We actually have two different kinds of facilities being operated by private vendors. One type is in partnership with local communities. Those are our community correctional facility beds. Those are in-state, and they are truly level 1 and 2 beds, and we do have a surplus of those. And so we're working with the vendors and the communities to try to fill those beds. We're going to be changing one from a male facility to a female facility to try to deal with those empty beds, so that obviously we don't want to pay for beds that we can't use. The out-of-state beds that Mr. Brown was referring to are, for the most part, level 3 beds, which are the higher-level offenders needing celled construction. And so those we are overcrowded in. And in fact, the suggestion that we not go forward with AB 900, I strongly oppose, in that it's the reason that the costs have gone up is that we've shifted the idea from building more dormitories for low-level offenders that we don't need, which the original cost estimates were made on, to celled facilities for offenders that are in fact impacted by overcrowding. And so you would expect the costs to go up, but I think we should be preparing for a prisoner release order. Even though the administration will appeal that order to the Supreme Court, nonetheless, being able to provide additional capacity for our high-level offenders so that we can provide programming for them, I think, is an important goal to keep.
Okay. I'm interested in the private prisons because I did, I was interested and did some research on them. Most of them are in rural areas. Do prisoners get assigned to those prisons, or do they volunteer to go to those prisons? They are sort of returning facilities, right, that people would go there in their last year or so of incarceration?
The in-state facilities are...
Yeah, the in-state ones. They're all in Kern County and San Bernardino County and certain, they're in about three or four counties, it seems to me, not in any urban areas.
I think that's true for the most part, and we don't, they're not volunteers. They're drafted.
So we just don't have enough one and two level beds, level prisoners to fill the beds?
That's right.
Do we have wobblers? No, I don't know how the designation system for prisoners works, but it would seem to me to have empty beds and then the kind of grotesque overcrowding we have in some of our other state prisons.
Yeah, so we've asked the private providers and the community providers to see if they can't convert those facilities to provide a higher level of security so that we could have inmates in those facilities that we have. We can place inmates that we actually have enough of. And that's one. And then conversion to a female facility. We have more low-level female offenders, for example, is another good idea. So we're working with our providers to try to address that problem. They go first to the fire camps, for example, but there are a lot of those kinds of beds. They're, you know, it's mm-hmm. it's not nearly as expensive to build a big dorm as it is to build a cell, and so.
Yeah, well, I would hope we could look at that and see how we could fill those beds before we do some of the other more expensive things. How much does each one of those beds cost the state a year?
Mm. You know, Dave?
It's a little over $20,000 a year for each one of those beds.
Oh, as opposed to $49,000 a year in an ordinary regular state prison.
Compared to the average cost, yes, it's significantly less. But as far as the marginal cost of adding or subtracting an inmate to a prison bed, it's very similar to that cost.
Are there services provided in those correctional facilities?
It depends on which one you're at. Some do a very good job. For example, we have a women's facility just north of here
in Live Oak
that provides trauma-informed drug treatment to the 200 women who are in that facility. They do a terrific job. We have others that provide little programming for the inmates who are there for their last year or so. So it's across the spectrum.
Yeah. And do we have any data on recidivism from those facilities?
I know that when we operate new programs, we gather recidivism data on those new programs. As to facility by facility, I don't believe we do.
And part of the problem in terms of a recidivism based on a facility is many of our offenders move around from facility to facility and engage in different kinds of programs. So there's not always a correlation between what the offender's recidivism rate is versus where they left.
Okay. Well, thank you. We can all try to figure out more about how to use those beds, how to get services in those facilities, because if the only reason they're cheaper is because they don't deal with the problems and people are having the same recidivism rate when they return to the community, we might want to rethink a lot of those things. But I thought the out-of-state bed question was a very good one. The other also suggested by Mr. Brown was that there are 1,500 vacancies in headquarters right now, and if we swept the vacancies, we could save considerable money.
Justin Howard, Department of Finance. Like the Secretary said, a lot of those numbers are in dispute right now. We believe it's significantly overstated. Also, to the extent those that there, we'll acknowledge there are some vacancies, but those vacancies and then the associated funding with those vacancies would be used as overtime because the workload is still there. Just because the position is vacant doesn't mean the workload for which that position was provided for does not exist. So other people are performing that workload, and typically they would be doing that on an overtime basis. So sweeping vacant positions would not solve the problem.
Okay. Again, I would hope that you would look very carefully at, say, planning functions for which there might be no money for implementation, or various kinds of really looking at every vacant position and see if it's something that we could do without for a while to get to the 400, because 400 million is a small percentage when we're looking at some of the other services that are going to be cut. And in that line, Ms. Dowden said that education employees in our prisons have gotten layoff notices. Is that correct? And that would seem to me to be counterproductive, given our conversation up to now.
There are, as the governor's order has indicated, there'd be 5,000 statewide layoff notices. We're about 68% of all state general fund positions are in the Department of Corrections, and so that's about 68% of the 5,000. It didn't go to just teachers. It went to literally every classification, with the exception of court-ordered clinicians received, anybody who's been in state service 15 months or less received a layoff notice. That what we still have to do, though, is decide what policies are we going to employ that would allow us to reduce those positions. This is the start of that layoff process, but we don't know whether the classifications will all be accepted. We don't know exactly what the numbers will be, and we certainly don't know who those people will be. It's just the beginning of that process.
So in other words, it's like pink slips in schools, mm-hmm. that you're giving people notice that their position may be eliminated, but it also may not. Well, my concerns would be definitely that we not lay off the service providers that will prepare people to go back to the community and not become recidivists. And also, Ms. Dowden mentioned something about paper records, a lot of paper records. I also hope you won't cut your IT services. I think that getting accurate data on what's going on, and having come from a local government that literally revolutionized itself by simply getting a good computer system and being able to track things, I think that's a very important step for the work you're trying to do in stabilizing the department.
I agree with that.
Thank you, Senator. And with the last word, Chairman Arambula.
Thank you, Chair Leno. Once again, I really appreciate you being in the situation and the positions that you are, and I look forward to working with you because I think you have the right attitude and the right perspective. I just wanted to comment briefly on the civil liberties versus the budget issues. Civil liberties are important, but I am primarily concerned about the budget today, and particularly today, given the voting that is going on and its impact on our fiscal situation. Whatever savings we achieve ought to be certain. We ought to be able to count on them, and we need to count on them because while we're looking at the February proposals, the February adopted budget, we just received a few days ago the May revise. And to put it in context, we're looking at the elimination of Medi-Cal for legal law-abiding immigrants. We're looking at reducing help for the aged, for the blind, and for the disabled. We're looking at reducing family planning services, and in my area we have a very high pregnancy rate. We're looking at increasing fees for veterans to spend their last days in state veterans' homes. We're looking at the reduction of opportunity for placement for foster kids with extended family. 225,000 children under the May revise will lose health coverage. And we're looking at things like the elimination of the Poison Control Center, and I could go on and on. So the reason I mention these, Mr. Chairman and members, is to point out how important it is that we achieve some savings in CDCR. Just out of fairness and trying to balance competing priorities in the state. And I hope we can do so in a way that acknowledges that there are spillover impacts on local governments, on county jails, on the courts, on the need for substance abuse treatment. I would rather have greater savings and plow back some of those savings into the kinds of services that will be helpful to make sure that in the long run we decrease the rate of recidivism and decrease over time the cost for running the state penal system. So I encourage you to look at this proposal and possibly consider some tweaks that will achieve the certainty in the budget reductions, and also to the extent possible that plows back some of those savings to provide the long-term relief. So thank you for what you're doing. It's much appreciated.
Thank you, Assemblyman Arambula, for framing that for us. If we can believe the recent Public Policy Institute poll, all of the services and programs you've just mentioned are exactly the ones voters have said do not cut, where they did say cut from the Department of Corrections. So we should be listening to them as they are going off to the polls today. We'll have to be listening to them as a result of that vote. Mr. Secretary, Ms. Hayhoe, Mr. Lewis, Department of Finance, thank you for your time today and walking us through all of this. We clearly have a lot of work ahead of us, and look forward to working with you hand in hand.
Thank you very much for all your courtesy and your time.
We stand adjourned.